Are there anybody who has questions right now? I've sort of been hogging this. I think the protocol is to please go to the microphone, sir, if you don't mind. And what I would ask, it looks like a lot of people have questions, which is fantastic. Please try to keep your comments, questions relatively brief so everybody gets a chance.
Okay, thank you. In the jacket cover, it says here that you predict a bigger, longer economic crash than the one that hit us in 2008, and it'll soon be upon us. I happen to share that view, and I'd be very interested in your opinion, given that, or assuming that, in what form should one hold one's wealth?
I thought I'm not working at CIBC World Markets.
The investment banker.
I think in a very liquid form. And, I think in today's environment, you know, there's a time for the offense to be on the field, and there's a time for the defense to be on the field. And when the defense is on the field, it's not about how much you make, it's about how much you don't lose. And right now, I think that the place to be is in cash, because I don't think that short-term interest rates are going to stay here very long. I mean, history will tell you that zero interest rates and record deficits is a marriage that's not going to last. And by being in cash, you're going to be in a position to take advantage of that. In a world of no growth, or in a world of much slower growth than we have become accustomed to, that's a pretty challenging environment for at least today's stock market, because today's stock market still has expectations that our economies are going to be able to operate like they did 10 years ago when oil is $20 a barrel. And probably potentially the worst place to be right now would be at the long end of the bond market, because of course if interest rates rise, the price of a long-term bond will fall, okay? You know, when Greece defaults and Spain defaults, usually when you have sovereign defaults, the cost of borrowing doesn't go down. The cost of borrowing soars. And as I say, being in cash is probably the place to be. I will add one other little kicker here, and that is that I believe that triple-digit oil prices is going to take the Canadian dollar to places that it's never been. And that certainly is going to be something that one wants to be aware of, not only in terms of managing one's money and foreign exchange exposure, but I think that looking at what kind of economy Canada will be, I think the fault lines in Canada are going to run very much along energy lines between those who have oil and those who don't have oil. And just look how radically already oil has reshaped the Canadian Economic Federation. Ontario, which for years and years had been the check writer for equalization, is now the country's largest have-not province. That's because Ontario is the largest oil-consuming province. Look at Newfoundland, a fiscal basket case. Well, guess what? The offshore oil industry has made it a have province. So already we've seen how oil has dramatically redefined the haves and have-nots. And I think as we see some of the knock-on effects of oil in both the currency and the different fiscal paths that provinces take, we're going to see those divisions become even wider.
Good evening. Thanks for being here. I teach actually what you talk about, ecological economics, at University of Waterloo. It's not exactly what you're saying, but very similar thing. It's about the no-growth future that we have to face literally someday. My concern tonight when I got up and looked around was, what you're talking about, yes, it affects a lot of us for 10 or 15 years, but in 25 years, I'll be dead, for sure. Almost guaranteed, right? I'm almost 60, so 25 years, and I'm likely going to be gone. And the average age in this room is not what I would call youthful. sorry, but if you just look around, right? And so I'm wondering, a lot of this is really about the people a lot younger than us in this room. It's about, I suppose, partly about the people I teach at university, and it's hard to get some of this stuff across to them to say, especially because a lot of people at university have a lot of money anyway. That's why they're there, you know? We have a lot of international students. They have tons of money, or they wouldn't be able to afford to come here. What is your message to the younger generation? Yes, we can do lots of re-regulating, and I agree. I worked in the investment business, and I didn't do the CFA, but I did the Canadian Securities Course, the money market, and all that stuff. And deregulating the combination of investment dealers and banks was insane. During the Thatcher-Reagan period, when we did it, was just nuts, and we did do it, and now we're paying for it. So there are lots of stuff we can do in the short term, 5 to 10 years, talking about lots of policy change and oil, reducing oil demand and all that sort of stuff. And I teach urban planning as well. It's all about reducing oil consumption as far as I'm concerned. Sorry. My point is, what do you have to say for the young people?
Okay, well,
really young
I think
people in particular.
The first thing that I think you're going to see young people do is stay at home more. And the next thing I think you're going to see young people do is enroll more in post-secondary education, because already we're noticing when the economy slows down, the part of the labor force that becomes the weakest, where unemployment rates rise the most, are youth unemployment rates. And youth unemployment rates in Canada, and Canada has a low national unemployment rate compared to most places, is already in the teens. I think our labor force is going to get grayer. Just as the kind of economic circumstances, I say, will induce students to stay longer living with their parents, to be in school more, at the same time, I think we're going to see pensioners returning to the labor force, that people aren't going to be able to live on their pensions, that the capacity of pensions to pay the benefits that they have in the past in a static economy are going to be undermined. And I look at my old building where I still have a parking spot, BCA place, and there's an Avis rent-a-car in the downstairs, and you look at who's jockeying cars, and they're all like 65, 70 years old, and all seem to be having a pretty good time of it. You know, one thing that we haven't changed is our definition of the labor force. We continue to define it when we measure unemployment rates, et cetera, as 15 to 65. But, you know, look at what's happened to life expectancy over the last 40 to 50 years in North America. I mean, I don't think it's any more realistic to assume that people are just going to stop working at 65. I think, in fact, the kind of economic realities that lie ahead of us, we're going to see people continue to work long past their formal age of retirement. So one end of the labor force, the pensioners, I think they're going to have an even larger role in our economy than you see today. The other tail of the labor force, young people, I think they're going to play a smaller role in the labor force. I guess we'll have a more educated population, but we'll also, as I say, probably have a population where people are going to stay at home with their parents longer. And that's going to have a major impact on what kind of housing activity we have in the economy as well.
Sir?
You brought up the idea of a 30% reduction in energy consumption here in North America, and you compared it to Denmark and Japan. But unfortunately, in the areas of housing, food consumption, energy consumption, we're not modeled the same way as Japan and Denmark is. Our cars are bigger, we consume more food, and our housing certainly is much larger in terms of accommodation. So until we change those values in this part of the world, we're not going to achieve a 30% reduction in energy consumption. The other side of the coin is where the government is today in terms of policy, in terms of Samsung with a $7 billion project that's going to fail. That's where it's costing us for energy consumption. We never stayed on the coal model. It's gone. And now we're not even going to go on the nuclear model because the latest announcements have shown that there's going to be $30, $40, $50 billion to get that going again as well. We're sort of lost in a black hole in this province in terms of energy consumption. Do you have any ideas?
Well, you say with today's values here, we're not going to be able to do what Japan and Denmark has done. And you're absolutely right. I mean, in my first book, I talked about, you know, how people in the Middle East believe that they have some God-given right to consume as much cheap oil as they want. And oil, you know, is something like, you know, gasoline is something like 30 cents a gallon in Saudi Arabia. But you know what? People in Ontario also have a view, or certainly had a view, that they had a God-given right to consume as much cheap power as they wanted. But they weren't next to Gawar, as they are in Saudi Arabia, but they were next to Niagara Falls, which was the largest source of hydroelectric power. I guess what I'm saying is people's values are rooted in the economic conditions in which they live. The reason that Japan and Denmark has these attitudes towards energy conservation is you're talking about two places that don't have a lot of hydrocarbon endowments. I'm sure if Denmark had the tar sands or Japan had the tar sands or huge coal deposits, they may have a different sensibility around energy consumption. But, you know, as an economist, I have a lot of respect for the power of prices. And, you know, the kind of energy consumption that people in Ontario were accustomed to in the past, those days are over. And I think that we're going to see that as energy prices start to rise, and believe me, power prices in this province have only one direction to move, we're going to change. I mean, I'll give you an example. Like, when was the last time my kids ever turned off the lights? Never. Okay? But, you know, what do we pay for power in Toronto? I don't know, 7-8 cents per kilowatt power. If I had to pay 30 cents per kilowatt hour, as they do in Copenhagen, I can guarantee you that Jack and Margot would shut off the lights. Because if they didn't, I wouldn't give them any allowance. So again, I hear what you're saying, that we come from the culture of the car. I mean, remember when, you know, the previous city council got voted out because they wanted to go and slap a $65 surcharge on owning a car. Well, compare that to Denmark, where it's like 180% surcharge on buying a car. But realize that, you know, this is a car manufacturing place. So I think the hopeful message here is that as energy prices change, so do our behavior. And I think that, you know, in the here and now, the adjustment lies not in some magic new source of energy. The adjustment lies in changing the way we live so that we're less dependent.
I'd like to get your view on one more thing. Okay.
And very quickly, sir.
Okay. There's 2.8 million barrels of oil that leave Canada going to the United States. That's 1 million more barrels per day than all of the United Arab Emirates and all the Arabian states provide to the United States of America, which is only 1.8 million barrels per day. That's Statistics Canada information. So the question to you is, other than the fact that we're 1,500 miles away from Alberta, why are we paying these kinds of prices in Canada when we've got the resources in the first place and we're giving them away for nothing?
Well, you know, I don't know about giving them away for nothing, but I'll tell you one thing we're doing. We're leaving, if you look at 2011 prices, about an average of $20 a barrel on the table for every barrel of oil that we send down to Cushing, Oklahoma, which is where the Keystone Pipeline ends. May I humbly suggest that the reason the Keystone XL project was canceled was not because Barack Obama is particularly fussed about environmental concerns or the emission profile of tar sands, but that he enjoys reaping a $20 a barrel fuel subsidy at the expense of Canadian producers. Because that's the difference between the price of oil that comes into any US seaport, which is priced off Brent, and the price of oil that they pay Canadians for. And the only reason that we accept $20 a barrel less for oil is we got nowhere else to ship it from. Because Calgary has always been looking south for its market when that's not the market. Let's just add up what kind of numbers we're talking. The tar sands ships about 2 million barrels a day from Alberta. At $40 a barrel, you're talking something in the neighborhood 30 days, $1.2 billion a month, $15 to $18 billion left on the table. That dwarfs the National Energy Program. dwarfs the National Energy Program. And as you may recall, Albertans are still bitching about that 40 years after the fact, okay? I don't think Albertans quite realize how much money is being left on the table. And it's not just money left on the table for Canadian oil producers, but also for the Alberta government in royalties, and also for the federal government in foregone corporate income tax collection. So all I'm saying is, if we're gonna be a petrol power, and if we're gonna be a petrol currency, let's at least get full value for what we're selling, and we're not gonna be getting full value for what we're selling by selling it to the states. Thank you.
Sir, next question.
There was a very interesting experiment by the president of Iceland, and I wonder whether you have any thoughts of what lessons that decision has on Canada, and did he make the right move? If you remember, he did snub the World Bank and said, I'd rather listen to the people. So I'd like to hear your response on that.
You mean Iceland vis-a-vis the banks?
That's right.
Yeah, well, I mean, here's a perfect example that Iceland, that all had no real history of having a banking sector, all of a sudden thought it was going to become a global finance center. And, you know, unlike the Canadian banks, I mean, the bank I used to work for wrote down some $7 billion in subprime mortgages, but they didn't cost Canadian taxpayers anything. They cost CIBC shareholders. In Iceland and in places like Ireland, like the Anglo-Irish Bank, when financial markets blew up, basically hospitals and schools were closed because it was the taxpayer who had to take over. And I think, you know, the story, it's just another aspect of the story, how quickly we forget that nothing has really changed, that we're all as vulnerable to a financial shock today as we were 4 years ago. And, you know, when you look at places like Iceland and Ireland, you know, the fiscal legacy, the debts that they've left behind for average taxpayers, you know, one wonders why the banks haven't already been nationalized.
Having listened to you this evening, it sounds to me that your basic message is very similar to what the environmentalists are advocating, which is basically that we need to consume less.
Less is more.
Yes. But it sounds like you approach it, well, obviously your background is economics, and it sounds like, I just want to make a comparison, like people like Al Gore, they're basically going around the world exhorting people, saying that you have a moral obligation to consume less for the future of our planet and for the future of our children. Whereas you approach it from a very logical point of view, and it almost seems like, despite the similarities, that you don't, okay, so I'll make a comment, and would you consider yourself to be an environmentalist? And secondly, to what extent do environmental concerns inform your views?
Do I consider myself to be an environmentalist? Well, I guess it doesn't really matter whether I consider myself to be an environmentalist or not. I guess the real issue is, what does triple-digit oil prices mean for the sustainability of our world? And my whole book, if there is a recurring theme, is a theme of unintended consequences. And I think one of the surprises of triple-digit oil prices is that it ultimately may be the most powerful tool we have in supporting the sustainability of our ecology. Because if we indeed take the risk of man-made emissions seriously, and there seems to be with every passing year compelling evidence to suggest that, yes, there is some pretty dramatic changes in our climate, then I think that this is maybe the most single important thing we're doing. I mean, people will go, I mean, one review in the National Post said, well, climate change is small solace compared to higher unemployment rates. Well, if you happen to be living in a coastal area that's about to be inundated by rising sea level, you might take issue with that assessment. And I'd argue that, you know, for those of us who believe that we really are flirting with environmental disaster, What triple-digit oil prices does is takes that right out of our hands. And probably, I don't want to speak for it, but probably someone like David Suzuki would say, that's a good thing, not a bad thing. Because as I say, I'll put my money on the economy when it comes to determining emissions, rather than any Copenhagen, any Waxman-Markey bill, or any initiative that policymakers may or may not do.
That was a great summary. Ladies and gentlemen, the book is The End of Growth.